Harper Via and Harper Audio present Too Much Lip by Melissa Lucashenko, read by Tamala Shelton.
This audiobook contains words and phrases from the Yugambe Bundjalung language. The narrator, Tamala Shelton, has learnt the language within this story for the audio edition. Tamala's heritage is Bundjalung and Lama Lama country. She was charged with shooting the accused, who in giving evidence against her, made no secret of what his intentions were towards the woman. She, he said, was only a djinn, and he could do what he liked with her. District Court, Criminal Sittings, Brisbane Telegraph, the 31st of January, 1908. Owen Addison, 1943. It was Owen's first time in the big country town that thought it was a city. The boy had never heard a tram rattle along a paved street, never before seen a raised boxing ring waiting for him, empty and ominous under blazing electric light. The number of white fellas in the world was a revelation. Dugai burst out of every door, their pale faces staring at him, strangers to a man. The great yellow hope, he heard one of them say to the flash piece of mutton hanging off his arm. Owen swallowed. At home, his enemies were clear. Reverend O'Sullivan, the Gungibles, the welfare. But where was the snake hidden in this particular paddock? There. Over in the corner, a stout Gungi with a flaming red beard. Three more beside him, all wearing the unfamiliar blue serge of the Queensland Police Force. His mum's voice rang in his ears. Keep your jang shut tight, son. It's your job to keep the godbotherers away, so keep quiet and mind your bloody win. Her arms flung around him so tight his breath was forced high into his throat. His arms roped around her too, trembling. Pride bursting in his chest. I'm a man, fighting to keep us free. Me, Sissy, Bon, and the terror of it all falling on his head at 14. The red beard strolled over, smiling a smile to chill the marrow of your black bones. He shook Mr. Lewis's hand.
Corbett's the name. So this is him, is it?
He asked, swiveling to pin Owen beneath his gaze.
The new Jack Johnson.
Owen stiffened. Melbourne had rioted after the Negro Johnson had won. Men had died, and Mr. Lewis was a banana farmer. He knew nothing about Gungis.
Oh, Owen's no flash yank,
Mr. Lewis said mildly.
He's just a handy half-caste from Rivertown. Is that right, boy?
The sergeant seized upon the adjective.
Andy, are ya?
Try to be. Owen's chin jutted. The sergeant gazed at him, unsatisfied. He leaned closer and his copper's breath blew hot in Owen's ear.
You might be thought something pretty over the border, he said softly. But the last coon that got too handy round here swung for it. Got that?
He stepped back laughing, as though he'd made a fine and private joke. After a moment of incomprehension, Owen's bladder jerked in fear. He wanted to kill the man standing in front of him, but there was his mother to think of, and Reverend O'Sullivan sniffing after his sister's souls.
Yes, sir,
Owen mumbled, though he didn't. He'd heard the word 100 times in approval from older men. Handy with a horse, handy sort of a lad, handy with his fists. Now, somehow, in the instant between Mr. Lewis uttering the word and it ricocheting back at him, handy had become a steel trap. Owen's job was clear. Keep the Gungibles away by winning in the grimy tents of country towns, by boxing his way to the title Mr. Lewis said was his for the taking, by being the native pride of Rivertown, so authority had no excuse to come hunting down his sisters and him. But if Queensland didn't like its blacks handy, if Queensland lynched them for it, then was he supposed to win this match or not? It was a question gnawing at him when he ducked between the taut, white ropes, still consuming him when the copper's eyes bored into him on his corner stool, warning him away from handiness, and paralysing him until the instant his opponent, a red-haired chunk of a lad, was announced as our own Johnny Corbett. Owen knew then what he had to do to win, could guess, too, in a general sort of way, what the silver gloves would cost him. He bent and spat into the zinc bucket, his pulse hammering in his neck. Then the lad rose to stand lean and tall and black beneath the blazing lights which multiplied his shadow in four directions. All fear evaporated. This was the moment he had been born for, oh yes. His old people hadn't made him into a man for nothing. Owen made sure the newspaper fellow was watching and swung to face the baying crowd. He whooped loudly and slammed his gloved hands together above his head. Second round, he called. I'll lay your Queenslander out in two. The room howled as Owen turned back to look Johnny Corbett fair in the eye. There was no mystery here. The snake in the room was him, and by Christ, he was ready to strike. Owen survived the retribution that followed his victory. He went home a hero, stunned by the new kinds of violence in the world, and refusing point blank to satisfy any of Mr. Lewis's questions about his shattered face, his bloodied legs. He had understood early in the night that the price of his life would be silence. And when Owen died, a very old man in a house far away to the south, there were 7 decades of agony caged in him, held down by liquor and a steely pride, and by various acts of bastardry his family could never quite manage to forget. But he had held one thing dear. Since the night the sergeant locked the cell door behind them, laughing with the other white men waiting there, nobody, not his wife, nor his brother, nor any of his descendants, would ever see Owen Addison cry. He had left his tears behind on the cracked cement floor of a Queensland watchhouse. Part 1. Less is Less. Chapter 1. A stranger rode into town, only it wasn't a stranger. It was Kerry, come to say goodbye to Pop before he fell off that perch he'd been clinging to real stubborn way for so long. Cancer, Ken reckoned. Never mind cancer. You couldn't kill the old bastard with an axe. But, no good. The call come last night. Get yourself home. Chop, chop. Kerry dropped into second as she cruised past the corner store, clocking the white normal savages. 12 blue eyeballs popping fair out of their Moogle heads at the sight of her. Skinniest dark girl on a shiny new soft tail. Heart attack city, true's God. So, yeah. Let's go for it, eh, you mob? Let's all have a real good dory at the blackfella du jour. Kerry resisted the urge to elevate both middle fingers as she rode past the astounded locals, past the produce store, past Frankie's mechanical, past the vacant lot with its waist-high weeds hiding a generation's worth of fag ends, torn condom wrappers, and empty bottles, past the landmark pub which hadn't changed in a century and wasn't about to start now, thanks very much all the same. And when Kerry had made it to the other end of Main Street, that was about it for Drongo. Place of Centrelink fraud, according to Ken. Population, 320. Now, as ever, if you wanted anything more complicated than a beer, a bale of hay, or a loaf of last week's bread from Kath at the General Inconvenience Store, you had to make tracks for Paddo, half an hour up the highway. As Drongo petered out, Kerry throttled back. She stopped at the T-junction of Main and Mount Monk Road, and straightened first one stiff leg, then the other, letting her toes point skyward in heavy black leather boots. $20,000 of American heritage engineering shifted in her hands as she did. Right boot out, a small tilt to the left. Left boot out, small tilt to the right. Then, in a futile gesture towards flying under the gossip radar for at least the afternoon, Kerry turned the bike off. Silence expanded around her. She flipped her visor up and flinched. Late December bouncing straight up at her off the tar. 11 in the morning and already the road soft beneath her boot heels. Sweat broke out on her forehead as she gazed around the empty intersection and the paddocks beyond it. Been a fair while, Kerry murmured to nobody and to everybody. Been a fair old while. She let out a sharp bark of laughter. There was no telling what today might bring, or who might be alive at the end of it. Same as any other fucking day in Drongo. In other words, only more so. 3 wark flapped down onto the road beside her, drawn to the flattened remains of a King Brown which looked to have lost a fight with Scruffy McCarthy's cattle truck. The birds stared at Kerry, cawing obnoxiously before they turned to their snake, and promptly ripped it in half. The biggest crow seized the open-jawed front end of the carcass and hopped with glee to the grassy verge. Hungry, it plunged hard into the rotting head, seeking out the reptile's soft brain, and then looked up, totally baffled. The fanged snake skull had gotten wedged hard onto the bird's beak. The crow shook its head, first in surprise and then in anger, but to no avail. Kerry watched, fascinated and appalled. Would the crow manage to free itself? Or would the Mundulan have the last grim laugh, its hard, tiny skull locking the crow's beak shut until the bird starved to death? The eaters and the eaten of Durango, having it out at the crossroads. You don't see old mate Freddie McCubbin painting that, do you? Talk about down on his fucking luck. The other crows noticed their companion's plight. Ha ha ha. Looks like a mutant. Half a bird and half a snake, mocked the one on the left. Are you stuck? Asked the other, falling about with delight at its own wit. I'm not the only one in Jurongo plagued by arseholes then, Kerry noted. Yugam Bagljung, Waluia Gully, the luckless crow complained. My beak's no good. You could help a bird. Kerry looked around the deserted road. Yugam Bagljung, Buyala Gully, Yugam Yan Mugul, Guri, Brisbane you? You could help, instead of sitting up there like a mug glare from the city. Kerry looked around again. The wark hopped up and down in rage. Then the second crow chimed in, dripping scorn. It's no good to ya, fang face. Can't talk lingo. Can't even find its way home. Turned right at the Cow River when it should have kept going straight. It's as muggle as you look. How the hell do you lot know where I've been? Kerry retorted. Back in town 5 minutes and the bloody wildlife keeping tabs on her already. The second crow preened as it gave her a self-important sideways glance. Us wark see all that happens. We see the platypus in his burrow at midnight. We see the dingo bitch in her lair under the new moon. We see... The third crow butted in, impatient. Oh, shut up, you bloody blowhard. Make me sick, true's God. Old Grandfather Pelican went and told our auntie's second cousin he's seen you get lost at the bridge. Goodest blackfella. The third crow sharpened its beak on the bitumen in contempt. Kerry turned to the trapped bird, pulling her hair up in a tight ponytail to get it off her neck. Because Jesus Christ Almighty, the heat. I'll help if you fly up here, she offered, tapping her handlebar. The other crows instantly began to shriek in alarm. The snake crow tilted its mutant head at her. Galganalela, Bunjalung. Speak Bunjalung, a test of good character. Bunjalung noya yugam baugul, she said. My Bunjalung is crap. The bird hesitated. It's a trap, a trap, a trap! The other crows screeched. The sun beat down on four black heads as 1 minute passed, and then another. Kerry shrugged and kicked the Harley to life again, the enormous V engine booming like a bitch over the thistle-studded paddocks. Well, suit yourself, Bungie. I'm not sitting here getting cooked to death. With a last suspicious glance at her, the crow took two fast hops and then was airborne. Its so-called friends took off as well, bullying each other all the way across the paddock to the dead gum standing by the creek. Kerry sat for another troubled moment, feeling certain the crow was going to spend several hideous days before starvation claimed it. But she hadn't ridden 3 hours to worry about a doomed wark. She was here to deliver her final goodbye to Pop, and then fuck off quick bloody smart back over the border to Queensland, well away from anything resembling Jurongo. Revving the throttle, she looked straight in front of her, down a long gravel driveway to the house that Jack Shit built. It huddled beneath the spreading arms of a large leopard tree. Same old fibro walls, same old iron roof with rust creeping into a few more panels each wet season. The lawn bore a lopsided mohawk from where the mower had died or been stolen, or where Ken had run out of the minimal motivation he'd had to begin with. Gazing at the front veranda where the old nickel bath used to live, Kerry felt her scalp begin to itch. She hauled her helmet off and scratched furiously at her sweaty head. Ken still hadn't replaced the busted louvre beside the front door. More accurately, Kerry squinted, he'd replaced it with a strip of roughly hacked ply. And this had become a permanent memorial to the window his stubby had flown through upon discovering a $125 council parking fine in the mail. The offending falcon stood in exactly the same spot Kerry had seen it last Christmas. Beside it, another two old bombs kept the rusting XD company. Kerry guffawed. Jerry, she thought, still scratching the long-dead nits of childhood. They should have named him Jerry. Everything the prick does is Jerry built. My biggest blue-eyed brother. Such a fucking boon to the tribe. Suddenly not caring about the local gossips and their hurricane tongues, for she would be long gone this time tomorrow, Kerry revved the hog. In their distant gum tree, the crows cawed in mocking response.
Kerry revved the bike again louder and gave an evil grin. That's a warning to yous all. Big Dory locals, paranoid crows, flattened brown snakes, the big brothers of the world. Or maybe it's just a real deadly welcome home to myself. Cause ready or not, here I come. She threaded her helmet onto her left forearm and released the clutch. Plummeted down the drive to where Pretty Mary was continuing her life's work, cursing the inhabitants of Jurongo. As if anyone with two eyes in their head to see with couldn't have told her the fucking place was cursed to hell and back already. In Sydney, Martina closed her eyes, not believing what she'd just heard from the state director.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.